Hello, everyone. So happy that you could all be here with us today. I apologize for my absence, but my name is Jennifer Olick-Mueller. I'm a second-year psychiatry resident right now at Hennepin Center and also at Regions Hospital in St. Paul. I've always had an interest in mental health since I've been a teenager, and so I received my medical degree at the University of Nebraska in Omaha, and then subsequently came here for my residency in psychiatry. I do plan to have an emphasis on geriatric psychiatry, in particular would and love to work with a dementia population as well. I've been asked to speak with you all today about some things to be aware of when considering possible depression that might be co-occurring in someone with dementia. We're going to talk today about depression and dementia, and I have nothing to disclose. So some objectives that we will discuss today will be in regards to depression in itself and how it can be defined as a ripple effect. And in making diagnosis in this type of population, it is very complicated. There are lots of things to consider, but there are some criteria that we can focus on, and then we will talk about possible treatments to consider. And then at the end, just some tips on particular medications to be wary of in the dementia population. So in dementia, there a lot of neuropsychiatric symptoms that could occur. Some such symptoms might be agitation, aggression, delusions, hallucinations, paranoia, disinhibition, sleep disturbances are very prevalent, and then depression is very prevalent as well. One or more of these symptoms that I had just mentioned are observed in 60 to 90% of patients with dementia. The prevalence increases with disease severity as well. The presence of these symptoms leads to greater functional impairment in patients with dementia and further leads to cognitive impairment. It's important to note that the ripple effect can be described as the person who is experiencing depression is certainly affected, but also everybody around them are affected as well. It really does interfere with everyday lives and kind of the struggles to maintain that functionality. It's important to understand that when there are behavioral changes or mood symptoms, other medical issues should be ruled out. Uncontrolled pain may be a consideration. Medication toxicity and other causes of delirium should be considered as well to rule those out. But when one is depressed, like I had said, everyone else can be impacted, and this can be very distressing. But what can be empowering is gaining knowledge on important things to be aware of and knowing that there are professionals out there to help so that one does not have to travel down such a difficult path alone. So for this time I have with you all, we're going to focus on how depression might present in the dementia population and important things to know for diagnosis and treatment consideration. So first and foremost, it's complicated. Depression and dementia is very complicated. So the timeline is very important because sometimes in those who are not diagnosed with dementia, depression can have cognitive effects as well, and it might appear as a dementia process. So the timeline there is very important. Of patients with Alzheimer's disease, there have been studies that have shown that up to 78% can suffer from depressive symptoms, 77% can have agitation, and 69% can have psychotic symptoms. And over half of those people may experience all of those things. So some older adults who become depressed are at increased risk of having comorbid dementia or of developing dementia in the future. And it also works in the opposite direction too. Those with dementia are more likely to have a depressive episode as well. Some things that make it even more complicated are those difficulties communicating thoughts and verbal expression in those people with dementia. It's just hard to get an accurate picture of what's really going on in their daily life. So that's where caregivers can really step in and give a really good account on what is going on throughout their days. Some people with dementia have significant overlap with some symptoms that might be depression, but they might not be depressed. And some of those symptoms that might occur with dementia our apathy, troubles getting motivated, going out to do things, sleep impairment, and social withdrawal. And those might be due to just the cognitive deficits that are related with dementia. And also another thing to consider about those with dementia, underlying reasons why they might be depressed may be in reaction to slipping their mental capacity or as a direct biological consequence of the underlying neurologic disorder. And also, you know, other medical concerns, hypertension, diabetes, any other chronic medical illnesses that one may be experiencing in their later life may have propagating fatigue, slowing of their psychomotor skills, loss of appetite, sleep disturbances, and memory complaints as well. And then in addition, in our older population as well, the medications that people are on can be significant, and side effects between the two may be causing some symptoms as well. And so it is very important to keep in mind all of these factors that could comment. So some slides here showing a little bit of statistics on depression and dementia. Patients diagnosed with depression develop dementia 2.5 to 6 times the rate of the general population. And as many as 10 to 30% of patients presenting with dementia may also have depression as well. The U.S. Department of Health and Human Services, the graph on the right lower hand shows how at various settings, adult day service center, home health agency, hospice, nursing home, residential care community, all of these places have high rates of dementia. And also along with dementia, they have high rates of depression. You can see that in nursing homes, the depression rates with the dementia rates are actually the same. Here's another study that was published in the American Journal of Geriatric Psychiatry in 2014. It was a very large study, almost 28,000 subjects with dementia, mild cognitive impairment versus normal cognition were enrolled in the study, and they saw how they were doing now. And then they kind of followed them over time to see how they did. So what they found was that those people with mild cognitive impairment and dementia were associated with significantly higher rates of depression at the same time, as well as prospective analyses, so looking forward in time. So these findings do suggest that we should really be making a grand effort in effectively engaging and treating these older adults with dementia, but also being able to address any depression or mood symptoms that may be co-occurring. But before we can treat depression, we must be aware of how it may manifest in one with dementia. So it could look drastically different than depression in somebody who has cognition intact. Some ways that the American Association for Geriatric Psychiatry has tried to combat this is to have criteria to diagnose depression, specifically in Alzheimer's patients, but it can be related to other forms of dementia. So some things that are taken into consideration when diagnosing dementia would be if they are saying they have a depressed mood, if they do have decreased pleasure from interactions that they used to find interest in, if they're starting to withdraw and not wanting to go out on family outings, if they have poor appetite, they're not eating, they're not sleeping, they may be slowed in their actions, or the vice versa. They could be really agitated and restless, might be irritable. That fatigue or low energy can be a number of different things, but depression can be one of them. And these can lead to feeling of worthlessness, hopelessness, having guilty feelings, and also leading to thoughts about death. It's important to note that for diagnosis of depression, one of the first two has to be present. So they either have to say they have depressed mood or decreased interest in things that they found pleasure in before. And some other things that need to be ruled out before diagnosing depression is any other medication or medical illness that might be causing that. So one might ask themselves, so how can I start to have this discussion? How can I really see how this person is functioning, what their thoughts are like? And so here are some questions that can kind of get you on this track. Are you basically satisfied with your life? Do you often get bored? Do you often feel helpless? Do you prefer to stay at home rather than going out and doing new things? Do you feel pretty worthless the way you are now? So it's important to know when we should seek care. This would be when mood symptoms or physical symptoms are just out of proportion to what is expected. If they're having poor responses to standard medical treatment, if they just are having a really hard time participating in their medical treatment, and not engaging with care providers. And it's really impending on the function of their life and their treatments that could be possible. And so this would be a time when it would be reasonable to seek professional help. So when we're thinking about treatment for depression and dementia, it's multifaceted. It comes from several different areas. It might be addressing sleep, having good sleep hygiene, exercising is super important, eating right, good things into your body, having a really good support system, and being able to seek professional help, considering possible medications when necessary. Some behavioral techniques that might be implemented is a predictable daily routine, gradual reconnection to activities that they enjoyed, increasing physical activity, establishing good sleep and wake times, incorporating more exposure to natural light in the beginning of the day, and then validating, reassuring, and celebrating successes is very important as well. Going back to the exercise piece, there is a study in people with Alzheimer's disease that showed that with 30 minutes a day and education, they had improved physical functioning and less depression. There are also support groups out there as well for both caregivers and those with dementia. These are more for people with mild to moderate cognitive impairments so that they can actively engage, along with psychotherapy, music therapy, occupational therapy, and there is medication management to consider as well. So my last piece here is to kind of provide some medications that might pose some trouble in elder populations, specifically with dementia as well. So these medications are not completely down because there can be some use for them at some times, but it is important to be wary of potential causes that might happen. So the first class is benzodiazepines, which might be Xanax, Ativan, or Valium are kind of the more common ones. And these such medications can worsen gait, they can lead to agitation, they can lead to physical dependence. So there you should be really in brief episodes if anxiety is really problematic. Pain medications like oxycodone and morphine can cause confusion and constipation. So safer to use Tylenol, ibuprofen, topical creams, things like that. Hypnotics and sedatives such as Ambien can increase the risk of delirium, falls, and fractures in these older patients. A safer option for sleep would be something like melatonin. Skeletal muscle relaxants like tizanidine and Flexeril, they have induce sedation and weakness. And then there's also this anticholinergic agents, which might be antihistamines. Common agent is Benadryl, and also oxybutynin, which is for urinary retention as well. So these medications that have anticholinergic properties, they can impair cognition and they can be quite troublesome in older folk. Insulin can increase the risk of hypoglycemia and lead to confusion, as well as agitation as well. And then warfarin is an anti-thrombotic agent that can lead to bleeding. And so if someone is falling, that might increase their risk. So some tips to be aware of is, you know, bring all the medications with the bottles to the doctor's appointments, include vitamins, herbals, or any other natural products that they're taking, and then encourage an open discussion with the provider about the necessity of those medications, and always be considering any medication side effects or any interactions that might be a cause for some of the symptoms that are going on. Thank you so much for being here. It's been my pleasure being able to talk a little bit about mental health and what that might look like in the dementia population.